Welcome to our digital Playhouse this Friday evening. I happen to know that right now there are people looking in from Minnesota to Mahramesk, and you're all very welcome. Normally, if you're involved in an evening like this one, you want to be involved in something happening in a room, in the air in a room where people are sitting together at the one time experiencing the one set of things. That is not possible for us these nights, apparently, to do that. But in front of me right now, there is an audience, which Fiona McLaughlin has placed for the actors and for the rest of us. So what she has done is she has put objects and photographs and mementos which conjure up people who aren't with us anymore. These have been sent to us very kindly for this production. So that is the audience which the seven people on stage will be playing to this evening. Now, just to say to you, there are not seven exceptional actors on stage this evening. There is one exceptional actor. But as regards the other people, they're not professional. They may forget some things, or they may not. There are things they certainly won't forget because they can't. And because of the way those things come through them, I think you'll find what they're saying unforgettable too. So, as I say, there isn't a constellation of exceptional actors, but there are a number of exceptional human beings taking their stories out over that space towards you this evening. So thanks again for coming. About 45 minutes into this evening, there will be an interval, and then at the end of it, which all takes about 2 hours, there'll be a very short break, and there'll be a question and answer session, and we hope that you can stay for that too. Thank you.
Oh me, oh my, you make me sigh, you're such a good-looking woman. People stop, people stare, you know it fills my heart with... For flip's sake. Well, they think I'm picking that up, even another think coming to them. Now, nice people, don't get me wrong. But clarity is be damned. That'll be one of their exercises. Writing things down. Dragging their thoughts out of their poor heads. Kicking and screaming. But that's not exercise. Here's exercise for ye. A bit. Lovely people. I'd do anything for them, but I'm not listening to that. locked down by the bounty. It struck me just today that the cathedrals would hardly have used their Easter candles. So I went round this morning and sure enough, they'll not be using half-eaten ones in the next year. So they gave me these. See me, always thinking. Always thinking. I wanted to be a philosopher, you know. After I'd done my A-levels, I says to me, Da, I will want to study philosophy, Da. Good for you, son, he said. I have a philosophy, he said, me, Ma. You'll get out of here with work. And that was the end of that. Oh, Jesus, that'll be the ones that don't know their way around. I wish somebody could have asked me about all this. But oh no, I'm just a cleaner. Just a bloody cleaner. And if they had, you know what I would have said? If you need to talk to somebody, talk to yourself. Talk to yourself out loud like I do. Like I'm doing now. That way you stay safe. That way, there's no harm done.
What I remember about the 4th of May 1972 was, it was a beautiful day. And I remember running along the terrace houses that all backed onto the school football pitch. And in between, there was an army lookout post wedged in between the houses that faced into the school football pitch. And there was a lot of rubble lying about because there was a burnt out building there. I still remember it as a beautiful scene. And then the next thing I remember is I woke up and I was lying on the school canteen table. And I remember it was like talking through a fog. My music teacher, Mr. J. Doherty, was there. And he was asking me, was I okay? And he asked me my name. I told him my name was Richard Burr. He got a bit of a shock because he knew me very well. It was in his music class. But he wasn't able to identify me because of the extent of the injuries. You know, my eyeballs were out of their sockets and they were down in my cheekbones. My face had been pushed back to the back of my head almost. And all during the time in hospital, I thought that I couldn't see because of the bandages on my eyes. So I was making jokes about, I can't wait to get these bandages off my eyes. I teach you how to play football. And I'm sure that must have been very difficult for my family. They kept a constant vigil around the bed. But it was about, you know, a month after I was shot, I was out at home, and there had been various attempts, looking back at it now, by members of my family to try and tell me that I was going to be blind. But this particular day, my brother Noel, who was roughly 10 years older than me, took me for a walk out the back garden, and that's when he told me that I would be blind for the rest of my life. And to be honest, I accepted it there and then. I literally absorbed it and just moved on. Until I was on my own in bed that night and I cried for the one and only time that I remember about blindness. And I cried because I realised for the first time that I was never going to see my mammy and daddy again. And that was a big sense of loss for me. My daddy was a very practical man. I think in many ways my daddy was a very smart man. And, you know, he single-handedly put my education together. Around the time, all the advice my daddy was given was to send Richard to school for the blind. That meant that I would have had to go and live in Georgetown in Belfast 4 or 5 nights a week. And to be honest, that would have been more traumatic, more hurtful for me than being shot itself. It would have been like another price to pay. I'm not only shot and blinded, but now I have to live away from home. And I know that that was tearing my daddy and mammy inside because I had this feeling that I wasn't coming back. And when I got down there, they separated me from my mammy and daddy and took me around the school. And I can remember thinking, this is not for me. I don't belong here. My mammy said to me, Daddy in the car, Liam, I don't think we could send Richard down there. My mammy basically had a mental breakdown after I was shot, although that was never really diagnosed. So he would have struggled with all that process of all the advice that he would have been given. I mean, Daddy valued people that he thought knew better than him. I got grade ones of my CSEs, and my daddy come up, and he woke me up, and he read the paper to me. And I was a typical 16-year-old. I wanted to hear it, but I didn't want my daddy to know I wanted to hear it. It was many years later, my brother was telling me that my daddy was so delighted, because that day, he knew that he made the right decision. Many, many years later, 30-odd years later, I was told that my daddy, when the doctors told my daddy that I would be blind for the rest of my life, my daddy said to the doctors, "Can I give him my eyes?" You know what? Different members of my family who are older than me obviously knew my daddy and used to sit and watch the movies with him and even go out and socialise with him. I had none of that. And I must not been able to sit down and sort of talk to my daddy about me, about him, about how he dealt with my blindness, how he dealt with the whole shooting, and even to understand his forgiveness.
There you go now. There you go.
That's grand, thanks. There you go now. Thank you.
I'll be just here if you need me.
Okay, no bother. That's grand, thank you.
You sure now?
No, we'll see yourselves out.
Are you sure?
I will
Are
definitely.
Sure? But I have a wee thing for you. You have a wee thing for her? No. I have something for both
you
of you.
Stop right there. Don't pay no attention to him.
Right, okay then.
Look, we'll see yourselves out. Right, don't you be worrying, all right?
Okay, I'll leave you.
Okay. All right, thanks.
I was actually born in the Glen. The family moved into the Norland in 1960 when I was 15 or 16 months old. It was a happy place. It was a great place to live. The Norland was 99% Protestant then. Council houses with Catholics in the perimeter. The late 1960s, there'd be the odd skirmish when young ones would throw stones into the estate and we'd go out and meet them halfway. I started Temple Moor Secondary School in 1970. And on the way home, gangs of youths could cross paths. If there was more of us, then we'd win. If there were more Catholics, then they'd win. But we also had Catholic friends, ones we palled around with, so there couldn't have been hatred for Catholics as such. Yes, when July and August came around, your blood was up. What did that mean? It meant you were up. Let's kill death, think. Let's kick the Pope and all he stands for. You learn from your no-high. The two sides were no different. You watched and you learned. I remember 1969 and Protestants getting burned out of their homes atop Academy Road and other places, and we were next. I remember building barricades. I remember storing the petrol bombs. It was scary sometimes, but your adrenaline was up. The thought was, protect the home. Protect the home. But I had Catholic friends. I ran around with the Cliffords. They were newspaper people, and we'd deliver the earnings Saturday night. We'd often go for a bite to eat in Con's Chippy on a Saturday night. It was always the same order for me. Sausage supper, batter sausage, and a can of Coke. I wasn't brought up to hate. I was lucky, my mum especially. I never heard my mother say a bad word about anyone. We knew we were different and we looked at things differently and we had our beliefs. But it was the tension that evolved after Bloody Sunday. When that came ricocheting into the city, That's when the two sides really fell apart. When I look back as an adult, Bloody Sunday was a bad thing. But back then at 13, you weren't getting facts. As far as we were concerned, there was a gun battle, and if the army had fired, then they'd fired back, and they'd fired back because they were fired at first. But something else was beginning at that time, something of great personal importance. In the Glen, we had what they called a social club, built by the people of the estate. Back then, the government didn't do things, and the people built the hall. And the word went round that they were starting these discos, or hops, as we called them, on a Thursday night. There was a young guy called Ken Robinson, older than us by 5 or 6 years. Ken didn't smoke, drink, or go with bad women. Spent all his money in records. Ken supplied the music, and Richie Hamilton was the DJ. Back in 1972, they were trying to get young ones involved in doing things. I had a few goals at being a DJ. I took to it. I loved it. I loved the music. You became a showman, someone else. Clown's not the word, except the clown too has a different face. You're there to protect an image, and there are certain things you have to change about your personality and about who you are. When Richie decided that he'd had enough, I took over. I soon got gigs in Kilfenan, Lincoln Courts, and the odd one on Airy Street. I was doing this Thursday, Friday, and Saturday nights at £2 a night. £2 was 4 singles back then, as far as I was concerned. Later, with what happened in the family, music was to save me. In fact, at a crossroads, it's fair to say that music saved my life. In 1972, my father was a joiner for what was then the Londonderry Development Commission, but he was also a part-time member of the UDR. The morning after Bloody Sunday, Dad went to work as normal, and two men came into the yard. I spoke to the foreman and said, he said, that's the only joiner we have, pointing to my dad. They had wanted something made, either stands for coffins or covered for graves, and they needed them in a hurry. They were used for the funerals of those killed on Bloody Sunday. My dad said, I'll stay behind and make them. Away they went. I came back next day, and Dad said, they're here, they're wet, be careful. And they took them, and away they went. They come back a week later looking for him. We know who you are and what you're in, they said. Round about that time, they just started to murder members of the UDR. But what you did was appreciated, and you'll not be touched. Dad said, I'll take my chances in uniform, but you leave the house and the family alone. And they didn't touch him. Nobody in the family was touched when them men were in charge. Even in 1976, the house was attacked. First it was petrol bombed, then a few nights later, my mum was standing with my 2-year-old niece, and this massive brick came through the window. But later, a bomb and a coal scuttle was through at the house. My mum was crippled with arthritis, and there's no way she could have got out of there in a hurry. We moved out the next day. There were 4 or 5 men at the top of the street watching. Gang of youths came down, began to throw stones. But the men had a word, and the crowd disappeared. But I think the leadership must have changed by 1981, February. February the 10th, my brother David was shot dead at 4:05 in the afternoon. He was a part-time member of the UDR, and they shot him at a place of work in a timber yard. He had a brush in his hand sweeping the floor, and they fired 7 shots at him, hitting him twice in the back of the neck. When something like that happens, you have a choice. Grief affects people differently. We live in a society where, in their anger, many people would seek revenge. But as I said, I wasn't brought up to hate. I lived at the fountain at the time of David's murder, and on the Thursday evening, 2 men came to the door. I brought them in, and they turned to me and said, "You say the word and there's 2 going down for it." Very probably 2 randomly selected Roman Catholics. I didn't know the men, but as they saw it, this wasn't just a UDR man that had been killed. This was a Protestant, as part of an attack on the whole Protestant community. I could see my mother through the frosted glass in the kitchen, sitting in the chair, broke. "And you want more of that?" I said to the men. "You want to bring that to someone else's door?" "Well, I don't." We got the word out that we wanted in retaliation, and to my knowledge, there was none, thank God. When something like that comes to the family, you hit a crossroads. You can either go down one road seeking vengeance, or you can carry on as normal as you fit for in that situation. My brother Bertie went down one road and became very politically involved within the UDA. In November 2004, he was found in UDA headquarters in the city. He had committed suicide. Bertie was a troubled soul. I know he was angry. Very angry what happened to David. But I was lucky. I had music. Right from the early 70s, I had music. First record I ever bought was Chicory Tips from my father back in 1972. And music gave me somewhere to go. And you needed something to take you away from it, because there was no such thing as counseling in those days. But I can get lost. If there's a song I love, I can get totally lost. I mean, I love Bobby Goldberg's Honey. I could listen to Honey and repeat all the time. And when you were out doing a disco, you became someone else. You were someone else. Not so angry. It made you feel better. It made you better. And the music gave me joy and happiness and peace at a time when I needed those things most. And you know something? It still does.
Victor said that music saved his life. Well, my husband, Trevor Deeney, saved mine. In 1972, I was just a wee girl running about, not taking anything in. But on the 8th of April, 1998, I became a widow. And I took everything in. And it happened right in front of my own eyes. And it went right through me. On the 8th of April 1998, when the country was waiting on tenterhooks, they say of an agreement that could be reached that would change the political landscape of our country. My life changed. My husband, Trevor Deeney, worked in a car component factory, not far from where we lived. He worked there for about 3 years after completing various ACE schemes when he'd come out of prison. Trevor had served 5 years in prison for attempting to shoot someone. He had been a high-ranking member in the local UVF. So he served his time in the Mays prison on the UVF wing. The organisation had been a major part of his life, not mine. He joined as a boy of 16. That organisation came between us as a family and impacted on our family life quite a lot. It would be fair to say at times I was like the mistress to the UVF. On the 8th of April, 1998, Trevor was on a 40-12 shift and I left the house as normal to pick him up. When he finished his shift, he got into the car and we began the drive home. Coming up the Crescent Link Road, I noticed that the streetlights was out, but I didn't put much pass on it. We drove along the Ross Downey Road and down the hill and into the driveway. All of a sudden, we seen two men running. We didn't know what was going on, and we looked up, and there was two gunmen standing, one at the passenger one screen and one at the passenger door. They were wearing black jackets and freckled masks. Trevor grabbed me by the waist and he began to scream, "I'm going to die, I'm going to die." At that minute, they started to shoot. One of the bullets hit Trevor and he slumped towards me and I fell against the driver's door. And just at that minute, a bullet went through my headrest, nearly missing my head. Another bullet went right past my knees and into the driver's door. The shooting seemed to go on for a long time, but the reality is, it was probably just a few minutes. There became a deathly silence. I was able to open up the driver's door and pull Trevor right across. We both fell onto the driveway and he fell on top of me. At that minute, I looked up and I saw the gunmen reloading their guns. They started to come round the side of the car and it was my turn and I started to cry and I remember saying, "Oh, I'm going to die, I'm going to die, God help me." Trevor heard that and he released his grip and I managed to slide out from underneath him and began to run down the side of the house. When I did that, I remember thinking, "I've dropped my purse." What a thing to think. How mad is that? I ran on down and I had to stand beside the oil tank and I was frozen to the spot. I couldn't have moved even if I had wanted to. And I had to watch as these two gunmen fired shots into my husband's body. With every bullet that went in, his body flinched. Again, this seemed to be for a long time, which wasn't. There was another deathly silence. And this time I thought, "They're coming down now for me. They're coming down the side of the house now. I'm going to be next." I stood there until I felt it was safe to go under the house. And I remember crawling on my hands and knees into the kitchen. I managed to phone the ambulance and I rang down to my mommy's house. My brother answered the phone and I was crying, going, "Trevor's been shot. I need you to come quickly, quickly." I went out into the hall and I stood there. And I knew I needed to go out to Trevor. But I was scared. But with the adrenaline and knowing it was the right thing to do and that he needed me, I went outside. But the strange thing was, I didn't go near him. I ran down the bottom of the street and back up again with my mouth open, not saying anything. The ambulance and my brothers all seemed to come at the same time. And to this day, how I got to the hospital, I don't know. We were all put into a resuscitation relatives room. And the doctor came out and said, Mrs. Deeney, your husband is very ill. It's going to be an uphill struggle, but we will do our best. A short time later, he came back out, said he was sorry. Trevor was dead. He had drowned in his own blood. The doctor let Trevor's brother, Robert, and me go into the resuscitation room to see him. And below the bed, there was white sheets surrounding the whole way round, and they were saturated in blood. The blood was running down his arm, onto his hand, through his fingertips. Drip, drip, drip. His body, it was like a human sieve. The next few days passed as a blur. There was hundreds of people coming in and out of the house. On the day of Trevor's funeral, the police lined the two sides of the street with Land Rovers. There was hundreds of people attended the funeral, along with local, national and international press, who were very intrusive and invasive. They weren't worried about us as a family. All they were worried about was, did Jeffrey Deeney get out for the funeral? Which one is he? They had no respect that we were laying a loved one to rest. To them, it was like a media circus. Trevor got buried on the 10th of April, 1998, a very poignant day for our country. That's the day the Good Friday Agreement was signed, but it was 2 days too late for our family. The next few weeks and years, there was lots of ups and downs, lots of depression, lots of mental health. I could remember taking the kids to school and thinking, let's set the alarm now so I can get up again just in time to go and pick them up. And I'd get back in the bed and I would think, I don't want to love, I want to die. I used to lie there and think of ways how to kill myself because I felt I couldn't cope and couldn't go on. But there was something inside me that told me, you need to pull yourself together. You need to try your best, for you have four young children, aged 12, 10, 8, and 7, and they need you. Money was tight. As I said, there was lots of ups and downs. But the one thing that I can say that my greatest achievement in my life has been is the bringing up of my four children. They have turned into four beautiful, caring, responsible adults. I believe as a parent, it was my job to be their primary educator and to teach them that there's right and wrong, to teach them to judge people for who they are, not what they are or what school that they go to. And I was very lucky. I now have the pleasure of having 8 amazing grandchildren. I refuse to define myself as a victim. I refuse to define myself as a survivor. I'm me. In 1972, I was a small girl. And in 1998, I became a widow like so many people before me. I never thought anybody would be interested in hearing my story. But I feel the time's now right for people to know.
You're a better man than me, the pair of you. My dada used to say, if everything's in its place, you know where you are. One decent man, my dad. And a very clean man. That's not a big thing with people nowadays. Cleanliness. Or it wasn't before the coronavirus. And if that has taught us one thing, it's that keeping away from each other keeps us away from harm. You have to admire those people, though. Still standing, wanting to do good, wanting to forgive. I can't even forgive my wife after all of this time. She walked out on her sacred vows and over what? Me not paying attention, but you could credit that. What did she want? I'll tell you. She wanted to talk. She wanted to chittering all of a bloody time. She wanted a budgie. Well, there's a time for talk, maybe. A time and a place. But you couldn't tell some people that. And do you know how I know it's not time for my wife's sort of talk here in Northern Ireland? Empty our whole heads out on the table talk. Because there's no songs about it. When people's ready for something, they sing songs about it. We shall overcome. We shall not be moved. Oh, you won't get me. I'm part of the union. So sing if you're glad to be gay. Someone writes them, and people sing them when they're ready. And we're not ready to say everything and to forgive everything. There's no such songs about them things just yet. I mean, there's no such songs about a thing. It's not time for it. Well, that's my story anyway, and I'm sticking to it.
I've always felt that I've been in a relationship with somebody that I've never met. In many ways, it's like looking into a shadow where there's somebody there, but you don't know who they are. And that person has played such an important part in my life. So eventually, after 33 years, I found out who the soldier was that shot me, and his name's Charles. So I sent him a letter, and I think my letter was fairly warm and friendly. And it's a very hard thing to do when you sit down to write a letter to somebody like that, to try and capture in a few pages what your motivation is, the person that you are, and why you want to meet them. Because I knew there would have been a level of suspicion on his part, possibly. I didn't know how he would receive it. But the letter I got back, I think, was certainly not as warm or as friendly as what mine was. For example, in the letter he said that he never felt guilty about shooting me and that he felt justified. And I can remember how those words literally jumped out of the page at me, and it did kind of stop me in my tracks. But there was another line at the end of the letter which I kind of, after a few hours, I sort of began to focus on more than the guilt and the feeling justified. And that was that, with the benefit of hindsight, he regrets ever firing the rubber bullet. And I suppose when I got looking at the letter in more detail, I realised he never signed the letter. The letter was typed, and his address wasn't on it. So I viewed the letter as more like a statement than a letter. And that kind of gave me an indication that Charles was obviously, in my view, afraid of the process. He didn't know where I was going to take all this. So in many ways, as much as he wanted to meet me, I think, he was shoring up his side of the argument in case I would take it in a direction that maybe he didn't want. So eventually we met on the 14th of January, 2006. And that day was one of the most amazing experiences of my life. I learnt two things about forgiveness that day. The first thing is, forgiveness is first and foremost a gift that you give to yourself. So forget about Charles. If he wants my forgiveness, he has it. But that's not what's important. What's important for me and here, in my heart, for my peace of mind, that I forgive him. So forgiveness isn't about the other person. It's about me. The second thing I realised was, forgiveness isn't going to change the past, but it will change the future. And again, you know, the fact that I forgive Charles isn't going to give me back my eyesight. Isn't going to take away all those hurts that were caused to me and my family all those years ago. But what it did do and has done has changed my future. And you know, I genuinely don't believe I would be the person I am today, having the happy, contented, fulfilled life that I've had, and even being happy around being blind, if I had been wrecked with anger, bitterness, and hatred. I know forgiveness may not be for everybody. I know many people find forgiveness difficult, and that's fair enough. You know, sometimes I think we can expect too much from victims. People do struggle to forgive, and that is totally understandable. But I share my story and share my thoughts on forgiveness and the hope that it helps somebody, helps you somewhere along the road to deal with whatever hurt you've experienced. We're not going to rightify every wrong, I think. We're not going to square every circle, in a sense. So sometimes I think we need to park the past. And forgiveness, for me, is a way to do that. As well as that, I think from somebody like Charles's point of view, I think it's important if he did make a mistake in your life, if he did make a monumental blunder, and there's no question about it, Charles made a monumental blunder in my life that I've had to live with for the rest of my life. And thanks to the people around me and the response to my being shot and blinded, all that compassion and love that I experienced throughout my life, I was able to turn it into a positive experience. But still, I thank even Charles and others who do terrible things deserve a second chance. They deserve to have the opportunity to move beyond the terrible thing that they did.
He loved his dad, that man. And mine loved me. When I was wee, he used to listen to me as if I was important. He loved me so much, he forgave me when I... My daddy was my hero. And he knew things before other people. On Bloody Sunday, I was just 18 and I knew very little. But I knew I wanted to go and he wouldn't let me. But word started to come in about what was happening and I was going anyway. My dad barred my way at the door. "No, son," he said. "If you go out there now, you'll only become involved. And sooner or later, as sure as I'm standing here, you'll do things that go against everything that I have taught you. So you're not going out that door, and that's the end of it." Do you know what I did when he said that? I beat him up. This decent wee man, my dad, I beat him up. He was a barricade in my road in that moment, and I wrecked him. I'll never forget the look. But he forgave me. He forgave me, but his nerves went. He lost his zest or something. And it just wasn't me. The chaos here overwhelmed him. He gave up on hope. The light went out of him. Me too. But he's still the best wee man I ever knew. And he believed in me. More fool you, Dad. More fool you. And he's as much a victim of the troubles as if somebody had shot him through the mouth with a pistol. Somebody else. I'm not picking that up. I'm serious. We'll be right back. I know it's part of their, process. I've done it myself at my marriage guidance. But that was a cod. That was a bloody my minefield. There's one time the woman says to me, "Couldn't you say sorry to your wife?" And I thought, not a bother to me if it moves things on. But it was a trap, you see. For then she says, "Now, couldn't you tell her what you're so sorry for?" It had been a trick question. Those two were a team. It wasn't enough to say that you were sorry. You had to be fit to say what you were so sorry for. And then everything come down on my head like hailstones. I was at this, I was at that. I never noticed. I never picked things up. Well, there you are, I picked that up. So give me head peace. It's all covered in scoring out and scratches. It's like a paper had hives. I'm a married woman. 45 years married this Christmas. To a good man, my husband is a good man and I love him. But the love of my life, my soulmate, died in 72. He joined up in February and was shot dead 4 months later protecting the area. We'd been together since primary school in Belfast. They should have taken me too, and in a way they did. No, that's too much, and it's not fair to my husband. But I thought I saw my love one day, and I wrote this poem. Did you walk by me then and then in the daylight? Or was that a dream? My heart surged with sadness. The tears poured down my cheek at the vision I'd just seen. Please, oh please, look over here. This yearning is unreal. Your body, your hair, your clothes the same. My mouth wide open. I want to call your name. Your footsteps tread softly. I watch you walk away. Please, oh please, look over here. I hear myself say. Touch can never be again. Our worlds too far apart. Please, oh please, look over here to mend my broken heart. You turned my love, your loving eyes met mine and melted like snow through my body to stay with me for all time.
I was born in March 56 and reared in Creggan. I was the youngest of four, three sisters and a brother, the eldest, 10 years older than me. In 62, our father went to England for work. He didn't return. And in 67, our mammy died. So at age 21, my brother and his young wife became my parents, I suppose. And at the start of the 70s, that very young couple, they had their work cut out with me. Oh, the girl I was then, I was just full of having crack. Partying, drinking, dobbing school, meeting up with a boyfriend. I was living a life that was just fun and rebellious. Not one thought of the hell it was creating at home. But I was also watching what was going on around me. At times, I get really passionate and annoyed about things. Things like the army putting people up against the wall, putting me up against the wall. And I was drinking. And I was drinking in pubs. And because I was drinking in pubs, I was having these heated conversations. And I was getting angrier and angrier. Why? Because as I saw it, I couldn't walk down my own streets. If I wanted to go to Foyle Street, I had to go through iron gates, and someone would always catch my eye and say, that one's getting pulled over. I was getting thranner and thranner and just not learning. I can feel the anger rising in me now, talking to you, the way I felt at the bottom of Shipkey Street, standing up against the wall at the gate for 2 hours, waiting on the female searcher that I had requested. It took me a while to learn. I was the only one suffering. In the summers of 70 and 71, I'd have certainly been at the barricades. Because that's where the talent was. That's where the crack was. That's where you got a laugh. And that's where you got a can of Carlsberg. I've certainly been thrown stones, but never petrol bombs. I couldn't tell you why. Yes, I did throw stones, but me, I never aimed at anyone. I was so full of energy then, but all that energy was creating a lot of problems at home. Tension rose. If the dance was over at 1 o'clock, there was an expectation I'd be home by half one. But I'd get talking to people. Everybody stood around to yak. And then we might go down to Cassoni's in the Strand Road for chips. It could be 3:30, 4 o'clock, before I got back from the embassy or the Stardust. That created an awful lot of rows. Every now and again, there'd be a big row. And I'd have to move out and go and live with my sister, her husband, and their new baby. But after a while, I'd row with them too. And I'd have to move back to Craigan. Just before Christmas 71, announced I was leaving school. Another major row. And this time I had to eventually go and live with my other sister, who had only just got married and was living at the age of Shintalo. I was living there in January 72 when I got a job as a dental, shall we say, nurse receptionist. Dream job for me. The man went to Donegal to work 3 days a week. And when he was away, what did I do? Basically, I had people in and we partied on the gas and air. I was escaping a lot and I was drinking a lot. On Bloody Sunday, I was confined to the house, my sister's house, strictly forbidden to go to the march. And for once, I did what I was told. I went out later, after the news had broke, heard all the names and I knew so many of them. You'd hear a name and you'd go, huh?
But he was so quiet.
A few weeks before, my boyfriend had gone to England for work. And I remember I had arranged to phone him from the phone box the next day. I told him the names of the people who had died. And he said, "What?" He just couldn't believe it. I couldn't say I saw too much of the funerals, but I'll never forget the feel of them, or the sound of the wailing and crying that rose up. It was absolute grief, intense grief. And it spread over everybody and everything. After Bloody Sunday, there was this blackness, and that hung over the whole community. And it seemed to grow, and it changed me. I had this feeling I had to do something, but I didn't know what, and I didn't know how to do it. But one of our friend's fathers had a business on William Street. He was very well known, very well connected. I went up to see him. We had this long conversation about everything that had happened. And I remember saying to him, "Something has to be done. We have to do something. I have to do something." And he said, "Don't get sucked in, Siobhan. Don't get sucked in." But I said to him, "You can't just sit back, watch, do nothing. We have to do something. I have to do something." And he said, "But it's not your job, Siobhan. It's not your job." If I'm honest, I had a whole mixture of feelings. On the one hand, I was saying to myself, "Get the fuck out of here." But on the other, I just wanted to do something. And then there was an incident in Craigan. At some stage, it could have been May. The weather was certainly better anyway. I was walking home, and people had gathered outside the chapel gate. It was around the time of Ranger Bess, before or after, I'm not sure. Anyway, me being nosy, I went over. A soldier, a very young soldier, had been caught. And this particular person, active in the community, he was threatening his life. He said he wanted to hang him from the chapel railings. Well, women were squealing, "Don't do it, don't do it." Other women were shouting, "Do it, do it." The young soldier was terrified. It was mayhem. The intensity of that "do it, don't do it," it was unbelievable. And I just stood and watched. I couldn't deal with it. It was overwhelming. At some stage, somebody said, "Go and get Father Carlin." He was a priest, well known, well respected in the community. When he arrived, he was challenged that he was hiding behind his collar. Well, he ripped that collar off, and he said, "You're not talking to Father Carlin now. It's Joe." For me, him ripping that collar off, it was a visceral explanation of how serious this was in our community. There were more ructions, but he took the young fella away in his car. And I remember thinking, I don't want this. I don't want to be part of this. These are my people. But I don't want to be part of this. And then we had Motorman. Motorman, sheer pandemonium. We woke up to Saracen tanks, soldiers in the garden, not being allowed out, people being lifted left, right and centre. It was horrific, unreal, an unreal life. You felt like you were being squashed in, imprisoned, in your own home, your own area, your own life. And being imprisoned in your own life did not suit someone like me. When a week later, I was away to London. My brother said, I'll give you 3 weeks. You'll not last longer than 3 weeks. But off I went, barely 16 years of age, off to London. And I stayed 5 years. In the end, I suppose I didn't belong there. But when I came back here, there was a while I didn't belong here either. I was getting these dismissive remarks from certain people that I'd left, gone to England, had no right to call myself Irish, still in Derry. I went into psychiatric nursing and then health visiting. And I was placed in Cregan and the Bogside. I could not have been happier. I was home. And then word spread, as it does, about who I was. And soon, everybody in Cregan knew, she's back. But you know, I still carry that year, 1972. Still carry it with me. And how do I know I carry it? I can't really talk about it without getting emotional, or the fear of the emotion overcoming me. I don't think about it every day. I tend to not go to public things about it. But the day of the Savile report, Cameron's announcement, I knew. I just knew. I had to go to the Guildhall to bear witness. And I cried. That blackness, it has carried through absolutely to now. There's something about genetic collective memory. And those young people who are still impoverished, still disadvantaged, they are most prey to that blackness. And how do you stop that? How do we, as a community, stop that?
So sorry I wasn't here when you could come on.
You're all right, don't worry, not a bother. You all right?
Aye, just out of breath.
Oh.
And you can't even smoke here.
Oh, right.
Listen, this is for you. And the others.
Oh. What? Oh, what is it?
It's just wee things.
Oh, right. Thanks very much. Thanks very much.
Not at all.
I'll see myself out.
Right to be.
Okay. Bye.
And then see that you do. See that you fulfill up and do. See that you fulfill up and do. All right. Calm down, nobody died. Breathe in, breathe out. A nice woman. About the same age as my ex-wife, give or take. Which reminds me, another thing the marriage counsellor did, and I couldn't get over this. She asked me how my sex life was. I didn't know where to look. But they were staring at me, the two of them, were waiting for an answer. And I didn't want to let the wife down. So I meant to say, decent. Meaning, just like everybody else. Good enough. But what came out of my mouth was adequate, which I don't think was too bad. But my wife went into a tailspin like a flippin' Messerschmitt. But that's all in the past now, thank God. Oh no. How did that happen? There's ones won't come out. Whatever you do. And this one is a bastard. These people have got me thinking. This talking thing. The reason I don't do it is it doesn't work. When you talk, you're either asking for something or you're telling people something. When you ask, you'll only be disappointed. When you tell, you'll be telling lies. Trust me, I know. A friend of mine died in my arms in 72. I was holding his head and my lap was full of his blood. Am I going to die? He said. And I said no. And then he started to go. Do you swear, he says. I just swear on my daddy's life. He started to go like something melting in front of you. The weight went out of him. The light went out of his eyes. Tell my mommy and my daddy. And then he died. Where's the song for that? There's a bloody song to help you with that. There's a song to help you clear up your friggin' litter. Remember, you're off a feckin' womble, but there's not one for me.
You all right?
I It's a disinfectant. Like it goes for your eyes. It means it's sort of strong, I suppose.
Do you want to sit here and have a wee chat?
No. I'll sit in here.
No bar. I loved in my head. I had a powerful imagination. Loved the films, loved the pictures, the miners. I have us for Spartacus. I loved them Roman films. But what we were seeing on the TV in the cinema, it was right out there now in the street, right outside our window. There was lots of life and there was serious stuff going down. But in the early days for me, it was all about adventure. Of course, the riots, like, I loved the riots. I loved the riots. In fact, when there was ceasefires and truces and I'd be disappointed. What am I going to do now? There was a big horn used to go off at night. And then the rumours on the back of that. The B specials and the Paisleyites are burning down the Long Tower Chapel. That would get the people going. There was local men organised. My dad was one of them. With his yellow hat out of DuPont. Forgotten what they were called. My dad. My dad was an incredible man. He really was. Now, his dad before him, jeebers, I mean, he was just an old git. He told my father from the age of 10 right up to he was 14 that when he got to 14, he was out. My dad thought he was joking, but on his 14th birthday, there was his bags at the door, and that was the end of that. In 1939, my father joined the Royal Air Force, the outbreak of war, and for the whole 5 years, he was in the Lancaster Bombers. He was a navigator, warrant officer, and he came back at the end of it all, just back to the RB house in the bogside on the Doe. But my dad was my hero. He really was. He was a smart man, and you know, he started the quotes team in John Bradley's, which is now the Celtic Bar. He's always thinking outside the box. He worked long hours when he started in DuPont's. But when he wasn't working and he had days off, he had time for us. Time for his family, and he was the one I took all my questions to. And I had loads of questions, especially at the outbreak of the conflict. I had questions about England and Ireland and 1916 and the IRA and the war, of course. But he never spoke about the war, not to me anyway. I think when Bloody Sunday came. Well, my dad, I think because of his airborne military experience, he had maybe just a keener insight into what the parachute regiment were all about. And in those days, when there was riots or big protests or speeches at Free Derry Corner, I'd be in the middle of it because my dad was always working. And my ma, as they say, was a bit of a soft touch. But that day, my dad made sure I was shipped off to my married sisters in Rosemount, and I was held under house arrest. I was incarcerated in there, and I was itching. But the news started filtering through. First thing the next morning, I was out of there and straight down to Russell Street early. But I tell you, I seen just wee pockets of people standing different points where people had died, and the atmosphere, I never forget. I just knew deep down that something huge had happened and something had changed. Everything changed.
My dad changed. This wasn't a battle with the B specials. This wasn't a civil rights skirmish. This was war. You know, around that same time, my dad was actually diagnosed with cancer. He changed. He was smuggling things out now that out of DuPonts, like protective gloves and hard things. I didn't understand, but when he died, it just rattled my world. I'd taken my questions to my dad and my other brother, Willie, and you know, he bright. Just like my dad, you know, but he was at university in Belfast and his own things they did with him. My Manus was my full cousin, and he was a couple of years younger or older than me, but I looked up to him, and when we were very young we were really tight, and he was a great friend. Manus was shot dead just behind the shops, again round the corner from our house. Manus was smart and he was funny. And as I say, he was a couple of years older than me, and he was in 72, he was hanging out now with Euler crowd and friends and interested in girls. And I was 13 and I was still in the twilight zone. I was caught between, you know, girls and still playing Japs and Americans and football. But I remember the wake of my father. When the coffin leaves the house for the last time, hard part. And I held it together up until then. Manus was there throughout the week. And behind that coffin as we walked, I fell apart, and he was there for comfort and consolation. At the end of that year, I was somebody else. I didn't sleep well. That all started then, like that today. Just staying up in the wee hours through the night. There were hard things we were all seeing and witnessing, but there were things that I had witnessed that would also alter my life. Things that children should never really see. Like Brian Coyle lived in the same street as me when we were wee niggers, and he was interested in the same things as me. We used to swap comics, and I used to go to his house, he'd come to mine, and he was just a likable young fella and full of zest in life. And he used to swap the comics, the Hornet, the Victor, the Valiant. Brian blew himself up with his own bomb in my backyard, my family home. And I remember that day because it was a most beautiful sunny day. And well, I remember just the bomb going off in my ears and just running instinctively and opening the gate and scanning the wee garden. And Brian was in the corner. And the bomb went off in his hands. You can imagine. I just froze. I did, I just froze. And everybody else just piled in. It was only a few seconds, pulling nappies off the line and attending them. But for that few seconds, Brian just reached. He looked. Well, he reached out more with his eyes than anything else. And he died. Later on, I ventured back out to the back garden, and there was people talking about it in the community, and the word went out, and there was a clear up, and you know. But when I went out to the garden, my uncle was there, Nilly Devon. Nilly was just finding me fragments of Brian. And I helped them. That were undetected in the initial clear up. And we put them in tissue and with dignity and respect. I think my mother says a wee prayer if we put them on the ground. Brian was full of life, and that was infectious. Well liked. I think I just suppressed everything. I think I just, well, I just buried it all myself. I have big questions. I have big questions like, what's the meaning of all of this? Is there any meaning, any purpose, any reasoning? Is there a God? I just pulled them shutters down in my heart and my head. My dad was gone. Manus was gone. Others were gone. And of course, in them days, you know, you were invited or pressure to join this or do that or get involved with this. I asked that question. Could I bring myself to kill? Nah. The answer was nah. Because I'd seen it. Another journey started just the end of that year. The drink, alcohol. That was to be one of the biggest and most important things in my life and the biggest struggle. First years were great crack and, you know, just going wild. But then I was on it, off it, on it, off it. I was 45 years old when I had my last drink. And it was around that time, you know, I was exploring also. I tried everything. I was exploring this and that and looking into this and that and still having them questions which I was left with. And I decided, almost full circle, I'd thrown the baby out with the bathwater long time ago. But I came back and I opened John's Gospel. And I began to read. And I tried to read it like raw without any sort of conditioning or baggage. And I just read the words of Christ. And again, at the same time, I met these people in Bograna, above all places. And they said to me that you could have a relationship that was real, a personal relationship with God through Jesus Christ. I was intrigued by it. That got me thinking. And in combination with reading John's Gospel, I remember that night in that same wee house, in that wee single room in the heart of the Bogside, I reached out. I stepped out. I laid hold of someone that lay hold of me. I experienced just a filling of life. I was transformed deep, deep down, something deeply profound, something real reality in me. I would never be the same again. And I'll tell you, I never was. Well, most people these days, they know me as one of the Bogside artists. That's the three guys that painted the People's Gallery. 12 large-scale murals in the Bogside. And because it was beside Free Derry Corner and Russell Street, the scene of Bloody Sunday, and where this conflict more or less kick-started for us, then we knew among ourselves the three artists, Kevin Hassan, my really strong creative family, and my brother Wally, the real deal by way of just sold out the creativity. Wally and Kevin and me, we agreed that this would have to be something new. This would have to be a cathartic experience. This open air art gallery would be a narrative. It would tell our story, the story of the ordinary, everyday people who grew up in the middle of all this and seen all this and witnessed all this, people just like ourselves. But we also knew that it would be like a human document. It would be our story. It would have to be authentic. We're very inspired by a quote from Desmond Tutu, Bishop Desmond Tutu. He said, "The conflict is like an open wound, and unless you have the courage to look at it and examine it and then clean it out, only then will it really heal." That's what this was going to be. This would be something new. We would paint this story, and it would be an examination. It would be looking into the very heart of it, of conflict and a community, and what people do, and what our people do in response. But it would be real. It would be cathartic. For example, the Annette McGavigan mural, full cousin of Kevin, the artist. And Annette was just a beautiful young girl, a school girl, and she was shot dead by the British Army, just like Manus. It sent shockwaves right through our city. And we, whatever skill or craftsmanship or talent we had, we wanted to bring it to our work and to our community, and we wanted to do something that was meaningful. So we took responsibility for our work. We went even to the McGavigan family. We went to Annie McGavigan and her husband and the family, and we sat around and we says, "This mural of Annette would symbolically represent all the children, Protestant, Catholic, Irish, and English. This week here, two hands touching and the beauty juxtaposed with a fragmentation in the background and a butterfly, speaking of new life." They were delighted. They says, "Absolutely." In fact, we contacted the Parry and Ball family and told them the same thing. Could this mural represent their wee boys? And they says yes. Because they all knew that sometimes your loved ones killed in tragic circumstances can be just a name in a newspaper or just another statistic. This mural would not be. Annette McGavigan would not be just a name in a newspaper. She would represent all the children who died, who were murdered, who were killed. There would be a spiritual thread running through all the work, tying it together, a message of hope. the Bloody Sunday portraits mural are all inside a perfect circle. Why? Because the circle represents that they were in our circle. They were our neighbors, our friends, the people we knew, people we heard laugh and talk. But the circle also represents the eternal. No beginning, no end. Because there is a God-given human spirit that goes away beyond. This isn't all there is. It doesn't end. It doesn't end here.
The way he could speak about his daddy makes you wonder. There's things he can talk about, I suppose. 72 was awful. One hell of a year. But there was life in it too. And to be honest, there was something about being young, especially in such a serious situation, that was magnificent. People were still young and they found ways of being young. There was the Glen, but Borderland, that was the place for me. Every Friday night you could not have bidden us away from there. It was like you could let your breath out in the dance hall. I remember a friend telling me a sort of a funny story. He joined up. He was young and was mostly doing messages. But Dickie Rock was due to appear in Borderland this particular Friday. So he goes to his commander and he says, "Do you see that message that you wanted done on Friday? Could I do it on Thursday or Saturday? It's just that Dickie Rock's appearing in Borderland." Oh, I can tell you, he never asked again. Oh, I don't know. There was a kind of innocence in the middle of everything. And so somebody said on another matter, it's like this. We thought we were special, invited to some great banquet. What we didn't realize was that we were on the menu.
I'm the sister of a young adult, only 16, a wonderful young man who died in a bomb in Belturbet at the end of 1972. I'm the sister he never met, and he died on the Feast of the Holy Innocents, December 28th. And Paddy was an innocent young man. He was beautiful looking. I'm often told of girls who fancied him, and they tell me if he had have lived, that they could have been my sister-in-law. Well, I'm that sister. There was torrential rain that day, and Paddy was working with a man called Colum on a Calorgas delivery lorry. For whatever reason, they couldn't deliver the gas that evening in Belturbet, so they decided to stay overnight in the town. They stayed in a B&B, McCall's. I think the daughter of the house, Eileen, fell in love when she saw Paddy. But her mother was sick and she was supposed to be looking after her. But she said, "Mammy, if you let them stay, I'll look after them." So later on that evening, after they had their tea, Paddy said, "I'm going to ring a neighbour so they can run and tell Mammy I'm not coming home." That's the kind of young man he was. Paddy was in the phone box calling home when the bomb went off. And there was carnage. A man, Paddy O'Reilly, came down and took him out of the phone box and said the act of contrition in his ear. "People should know what was done to my brother." Paddy O'Reilly said it was a sad case. "An innocent wee boy split open. A memory I will take to my grave." His feet were in the phone box and there was blood baked all over him. "I thought I was a tough man, but I'm no tougher than the next." He was like a cinder. My mammy and daddy did not send him out to come home like that. That night at home in Clara, it was Christmas, so they were all up late. When the late news came on, there was a story that said two young people were killed in Belturbet and bombs had gone off in two other places. My parents and my brothers and sisters got on their knees to pray for the two young children and the parents of the two children who were killed. That's the kind of home this young man came from. What they didn't realise that night is that they were praying for themselves. And then, around 4 o'clock in the morning, there was a knocking at the door and stones been thrown up at the window. Daddy got up, but Mammy, being 6 months pregnant with me, stayed in bed. But when she heard the priest say, "Paddy's dead," she got up. She went to the top of the landing and she said, "Oh no, Joe, your father." But Daddy said, "No, it's not my father, Teresa. It's our Paddy. Our Paddy's been killed." And in her own words, the next thing she felt was me move up inside her underneath her ribcage. And that's where she said I stayed until I was pulled from her. That's how she said I was born. As my brothers and sisters woke, they were sent to different houses. The older ones were allowed to stay at home. It was only the older three who went to the funeral. My mother didn't go. The doctor advised against it. She stayed at home with her sister Maeve. She remembered hearing a noise that day. And when she tried to figure out what it was, she realised it was herself crying in her sister Maeve's arms. Whatever my mother felt that day, I felt. And it took me a long time and a lot of money to understand that. But our connection was huge. And years later, if she was at home feeling anxious and I was away somewhere, I would always know. Growing up, I never understood those feelings. I was nearly 30 before I did. My parents were very quiet people. They never spoke about this. my mammy and my memory would have kept it together a little bit better than Daddy. Daddy, all you had to do was say something sad and Daddy would cry. Mammy would have been a little bit harder than that. No, not harder, but she was a woman, a little more in control of her emotions. If it had have happened now, I think they would have broken up not long after. In some senses, what happened did break them up. They dealt with it completely separately in my memory. I know that's what happened. Him being one side and her the other. They had their own divide. But they loved us more than anything. And we'd all have the same thing to say, that they loved us more than anything, when they couldn't love each other, I imagine. But then there were times when I saw the way my daddy would look at my mammy, and I would look at them and think, if I ever get a man, I want him to look at me like that. He loved my mother. He idolized the ground she walked on. And that became really obvious when we were losing her. He never missed an opportunity to kiss her when she was dying. You know, I'm not saying anything bad about Mammy and Daddy. It's a miracle they functioned as well as they did. I don't know how she got out of bed, and I don't know how he went to work. I know that if it happened to me, if it were my child, I'd never celebrate anything again. But when their days were good, they were amazing. And you'd love going home on those days. But there were days when you'd go home and Mammy wouldn't speak and Daddy wouldn't speak. And it wasn't anything either of them had done. They just didn't have any words for each other. They just didn't have any words. It's at times like those my older brothers and sisters did much of the minding of me. Or I could go to my cousin Linda's house, who was like a sister to me. There was one time that we talked about this. There was a brown box in the house and everything to do with Paddy, all about him. Mass cards, newspaper cuttings went into that. And it was locked. My older brothers and sisters picked the lock on the brown box and read everything that was inside it. And when it came to my time, I too read everything, in secret. There was one time Mammy did speak to me. Daddy was after having a heart attack and was gone to hospital. And when you live in a small house with a big family, you'll sleep anywhere. So I was only too happy to jump into bed with Mammy. We snuggled up. I was 17. And I said, I was thinking that Daddy could have died today. When you lose your child, you can lose anyone, Mammy said to me. Now, I don't want anything to happen to your daddy, but I could go through anything again except having to bury another child. That's when she told me about the priest coming and me going back up inside her. It's the first time she really spoke about it. But then they hardly spoke to each other about it. Daddy told Mammy that Paddy had one mark on his forehead, and that's what she believed till the day she died. Although we never walked the same ground at the same time, of course I consider myself to have a brother. You couldn't not have a brother who's left such a void. And it's the void that's my brother, if you get me. My dad's void was filled with bitterness, God love him. My mother's with forgiveness. She had that kind of compassion about her. They were, my family, decimated. I don't ever recall Paddy's death not having been a presence over me, ever. And then, in 2017, our cousin Linda died. And 21 years before that, John, Linda's brother, also died on the 28th of December. She was my sister. She minded me. She minded my soul. Here's the thing. Here's what I want to tell you. That physical bomb that killed Paddy in the phone box and Geraldine O'Reilly in the chip shop, that bomb left a 6-foot crater in the ground. That hole was filled in and wrecked cars replaced. But that bomb killed something inside of my mammy and daddy. And there is nothing, nothing on this earth will ever heal my brothers and sisters. Nothing. That bomb ruined my life. And I've a great life. But that bomb killed something inside of my mammy and my daddy. And that was the death of the love they had. They all had. For somebody. It shouldn't have happened. It just shouldn't have happened.
That was powerful.
Oh, thank you. What's your name?
Me?
Yeah.
I'm the caretaker.
I'm sure you weren't christened that.
No, I wasn't. It's Eamon McGerrigan. Basil.
Basil?
Basil Brush.
Well, Eamon, here's a wee something for you from all of us.
What for?
For the wee bird you gave Siobhan and all you've done.
That was nothing. That was nothing at all.
I know. But thank you anyway. You were very good.
I didn't see that one coming. I did not. Except there's been strange things happening lately. Like this. Now, I'm not religious, thank God. Not a puff of it in me. But I've started doing this when I'm stuck. Like offering something up. Something that's beyond me, or a gift to someone else. Don't ask me, I couldn't tell you. But it seems to make sense. And then I heard a song on Drive 105, or was it Foyle? Anyway. It was like I was meant to, like I was ready for it. It was I Remember Everything, the last song John Prine recorded. And for some reason, it got me thinking about my ex-wife without wanting to kill her. I thought I might ask her to meet up so I could say something. Maybe that our sex wasn't adequate. Though I meant that in a good way. I could say it was grand, which is really what I meant. I might meet her and do that. Who knows? Anything can happen. And I'll have to think again about burying the bones of our stories. As if they were treasure or something infected or secrets. We hold them for fear that they'll hurt our loved ones, and maybe that's right. Or maybe it's the holding's the problem. I don't know. I've no coat. Or anything to clean with? Well, if those people have left any traces, maybe that's no harm. You know, I heard them all laughing this morning, and that really threw me. What have they to be laughing about, I wondered? Anyone would. But now I'm starting to think to myself that maybe you can't cry forever. You can't cry forever, like you can't hold your breath forever. Even if you wanted to, even if you tried your best, your own lungs would fight you for dear life. And they would win. And I'll tell you something else. Whether it's time or not, here's a song that's enough to be going on with.
We were young, like the year just begun. We had dreams in our eyes. We stood hand in hand by the rise of the land. We were the dreamers of dreams, impossible schemes. Then the radio said the blood's running red down the streets of the old town. Sound of gunfire, checkpoints and barbed wire as the days handed death down. Here we're love and light, we're gunned down on the street. Hope fades in the wake of a ticking bomb. You see, anything can happen, and only tragedy remains. They built barricades on the streets where we played in 72, on the day I lost you. Between the hurt and the healing, and we can sit with the past, without war, without bleeding. But I still miss you. I still remember the way you smiled. I still miss you, my child. Voices cry out from the heart. together we'll hold the line.
My name's Andy Doherty. I play the character of Marcus. He's the protagonist, Cal's best friend. He's 20s, young lad, lively, a charmer, a chancer. And he's growing up in Derry at this time where the civil rights marches are starting to happen. And he's his hands full between trying to pick up the gears at McGee University and come together for the civil rights marches.
Come on. They say them college gears are up for it all the time. We'll just put on a brave face. We'll walk in.
We cannot imagine Northern Ireland without
our music,
our dance,
our paintings,
our books,
our poetry,
theatre, it's films, it's TV dramas.
Can you? No, I don't think so.
COVID-19 has been hard for everyone around the world. As we start to recover, the arts will become essential to our social and economic healing and our well-being.
I've been involved in the arts in Northern Ireland on and off since about 1976. And I played in small pickup bands running around the country at a very dangerous time. And I watched how the arts community rose to the challenge that was presented to it at that point. And I watched how the people rose with them.
I am supporting this campaign because I believe that art helps shine a light on who we really are.
Let's celebrate our differences, our spicy originality.
I believe that the arts and cultural sector in Northern Ireland is the greatest opportunity we have and our youngsters have of bringing our community stronger together.
I support this campaign because the arts are such an integral part of my life and the life of my community. I don't know who we'd be without them.
I'm supporting this campaign because without help, our writers, our artists, our performers will be unable to do what they have always done. Ask the important questions about who we are and who we might yet be.
I support this campaign because a world without arts and without music to me is unthinkable. I don't want it to be too late.
At the moment, this same arts community is facing an unprecedented challenge of COVID-19.
I'm supporting this campaign because we shouldn't have to ask to save the arts. We should be asking how the arts can save us.
I support this campaign because I really believe in the crazy, freaky future of avant-garde contemporary Northern Irish twang dance.
But without support, much of our arts and culture here will be lost.
4 million visitors each year engage with our arts and our culture. And arts bring millions of pounds in revenue to the economy. And arts employ thousands upon thousands of people.
Many of our artists and freelancers will be forced to give up their careers. Please help us ensure that that doesn't happen.
We urgently need your support. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Hello, welcome to our question and answer, which is going to be chaired tonight by Catherine Stone, but from London, and it's actually pre-recorded. There would have been a delay or something like that. So Catherine's going to introduce herself, and then she's going to ask us, I think, three questions. So we don't know what they are, but we'll deal with number one, and then we'll go on to number two and number three. But she's going to introduce herself now.
Good evening, everyone, and thank you so much for inviting me to be part of your evening. I'm really sad that COVID and technology mean that I can't be with you in person or even on a Zoom call, but let's give it a go. It's quite extraordinary what you can do with a bread bin and a butter dish and a mobile phone, but there we are. I am hugely relieved that this evening wasn't the first time that I watched the piece. If it was, I don't think I'd be able to speak to you at all. It is the most incredibly powerful, moving testament to you and your loved ones, and you should be incredibly proud of all your achievements.
There wasn't a question.
So first question is to the participants, and it's this. How has being part of this piece changed you? Has it changed how you feel about yourself? Has it changed how you feel about those responsible?
Well, if I can come in there first, has it changed the way I feel about myself? I don't think so. It's always been... The knowledge has always been there. It was just that never had the ample chance to talk about it. This gave me a chance to not only for me to remember, but for me to get the story or the testimony of what happened to members of my family because of events from the year that we're looking at, 1972. Has it made me want... For those responsible, nothing's really changed against those responsible. I mean, I would love to see them brought to justice. Would it ever happen? I just don't know. But, you know, there's always hope.
Siobhan, what did you...
My next question is for you, Damian.
Right.
And when I watched the play through last night, it struck me... and this will surely be discussed in preparation for public examinations. Students will look at this for their degrees, for their A-levels, for their GCSEs. It struck me that there's a theme about gifts, you know, the gift that the caretaker gives, the gift that the caretaker receives. And in the discussion last night, there was a theme of the play itself being a gift, and the participants giving their gifts of their experiences. Maybe that's a deliberate thing, maybe it's not a deliberate thing, but I wonder if you could just say a few words about that, please.
I mean, the biggest gift, certainly, for me, is the gifts of the life experience, you know, carried out. And as I said earlier, across this space, from this stage, you know, through the wires to the company of strangers. And part of me doesn't really understand it. I mean, I've been beside the people and I know, I've heard that, you know, everybody has their own reasons in the end for doing it, or their people that they're doing it for, or the community in general that they're doing it for. But I still think it's a big, big ask. It frightened me at the start, actually. I thought, I will never... I couldn't give people enough reasons to do this, but then I realised it's not up to me to give people reasons that I mean, you could speak to this better than me, but you decide I'm going to give this over or I'm not, you know, and it's not for everybody, and certainly it's not for everybody at any given time. But Tom, I mean, why did you decide to make this gift? And do you understand it as a gift?
Absolutely. I mean, it's not something normally I would engage with, you know, as a visual artist, you know, painting and trying to express my experience and our collective experience of the people in the bogside through the conflict. But for me, it was trying to bring out that there, exactly what was said, you know, that there's more and that there's hope and that this isn't all there is, you know. And in telling the story, it's almost like inviting people to join the conversation and to talk. And it, so it it's the challenge of this production, this written sort of piece, is it's that, it's to say, something you said years ago, here's my story. It doesn't blow yours out of the water, but it's saying, where is your story? And that, to me, is the challenge in this.
Right. What about you, Siobhan? What do you...
I suppose I feel that I'm here putting it into context, I suppose, for all of the people who were just living normal lives in an abnormal situation. And we tolerated so many things that we should have never tolerated, but we didn't know how to not tolerate them because we were in the middle of it. And I just think it's so important that we realise that it behoves all of us to actually think about what is our responsibility to live together. And I think just putting it out there that it's actually not just the responsibility of people who have been traumatised to address that trauma and try and find a solution to this. It's actually all of our responsibilities.
Right. Well, Victor, a gift, you know, you usually pay for a gift before you give it to somebody. So what was the cost of this gift for you?
The cost of this gift, I think it's the loss of the life. Because there had to be the loss of the life for me to be here, to be able to tell of that. Right. It may be a gift, but it was a tragic gift.
Right.
But it was a lesson in life, if we get my drift.
Right.
So it's because of that gift, then I've given the gift of to people to hear the testimony, to listen to it, and hope that they accept it as a gift.
And Pat, like, people should know, and you'll hate me for saying this, this man turned down the chance to work with the possible chance to work with Nicole Kidman to be part of this. So there's a giftedness about that. But you, like, if I can say this, and you've gone above, like, that's true, but I'm also making a wee thing out of it. But you've gone, I would say, I can't say this, above and beyond, and you've brought your giftedness, but you've brought other things. You've brought things to the company, your experience, and shared that in a very gentle way. What was at stake for you in this?
Well, I mean, I'm slightly different than the rest of the people here in as much as I am an actor. But, I mean, I felt a huge responsibility to what was laid down in front of me. In terms of the stories, I became very, very much aware that the stories that the caretaker tells are actually owned by real people as well. Mm-hmm. And from day one, I actually said to the director that I would have to approach this with 100% honesty, you know, to represent the struggle of grief, the struggle of memory, the struggle of dealing with all that stuff, you know, and that's what I hoped that I was portraying. And the caretaker having a speech impediment, you know, was so significant in terms of that it's difficult to speak. The broken speech of the caretaker, you know, and yet, you know, he goes on a journey from being very cynical about speaking, being unable to speak, but he eventually goes on a journey where he does talk about things that affected him, you know, and that took time, you know, and in the course of this particular production, it took the course of the play. You know, and I think that is sort of reflective of it takes maybe a lifetime sometimes for people to come to terms with what has happened and their memories of it and their feelings about it. And it takes maybe a lifetime to get the courage to actually speak about it, you know. But in speaking about it, and it's happened to the caretaker, you know, his last contribution, he did not stammer. He donned the scarf like the rest of them, you know, the scarf representing truth and light. And he made an affirmation that life will win. You know, so that is the journey that I have gone on in the process, you know, and it very much was a process, you know, which I suppose every production is, but in this case, it was a very, very forensic examination of everything that was involved, you know.
Right. I got that was an important part for me as well, as to see the, you know, the stammer disappear. It's almost like in the process of the play, there was like a healing, you know? And I think the message coming right through all of it is that in telling the story, in bringing what is lying latent, maybe and suppressed, and bringing that out, it's almost as if it no longer has any power over you. It's not so much a challenge, probably the wrong word, but encouraging people to actually speak and to tell their story, because there is healing in that, and it is a cathartic experience in itself, you know.
There's just one other thing too. I mean, and the caretaker does say it, you know, and I think it's important, you know, he does say, I don't know.
Well, I was going to say that. I was going to say that.
I don't know, you know, so there's no right or wrong about
this. There's not, but from my point of view anyway, it's a journey from, you know, what you said in the little trailer, if the Troubles could talk, they wouldn't bother. It's a journey from that to, I don't know.
Yeah.
But to me, I don't know, in the way you portrayed it, is an invitation. I don't know.
Yeah.
Do you know?
Yeah.
Does anybody know? Does, you know, I offer it over. So that's an invitation. It's not maybe a complete sort of elliptical, I went from thinking it was all bad to it was all good. It's, I don't know, but in the I don't know, in a society where people know every, you know, at times we know this and you know that, and we will use what we know to hit you over the head. This is like an invitation. That's the idea. You know?
Very good.
Yeah.
My experience as Victims Commissioner was one of the most humbling, privileged parts of my personal and professional life. And I was very struck by the clarity by which people in this piece, all of you, were saying very clearly, either through your speech or through your presence, that you refuse to be defined as a victim. Your experiences have informed your life, but they have not defined it. Is that the advice that you would give to other people who've experienced your grief and your loss?
Who wants to pick that up first?
That's the age-old question: what is a victim? I don't regard myself as a victim because it didn't happen to me. I'm still here, able to talk about it. So am I a victim? I don't think so. It's how you devise the word, you know, and the word victim means many, many things. Hazel, even in her testimony, states that she's not a victim. To me, she is. She was injured. She was there. It actually happened to her. She was traumatized. She's a victim. To me, in my eyes, she's a victim. Yet, if you talk to her, in her eyes, she's not.
But when you say, if you don't mind me asking you, Victor, when you say it didn't happen to me.
It didn't happen to me.
But something happened right beside, you know, so your brother, or your two brothers, you know, so that's happening not that far away. And
no. I mean, when I look back at especially David's murder, the difference in me being there and the difference in me not being there is 5 minutes.
Yeah.
But In a way, I was lucky. I wasn't there. I didn't see it. I didn't hear it. Yeah. It wasn't it.
Could I ask you one other wee thing, which we've talked about this, you and I, as well as friends, as well as, you know, people taking part in this then. But you see the thing you say in your piece about music?
Music.
That music saved your life. And you and I have spoken about that because we're both mad for music. But, I mean, if I asked you the question like this, if somebody said to you tomorrow, or if somebody had said to you back then, listen, I'm really sorry about this, Victor, but you can't have any music anymore, and music was taken away from you as a redress or as a release or as all the things that you said it was, do you really think it would, like, that would have maybe been even too much of a loss?
It probably would have. I still regard myself as very, very lucky that I had the music. There was something to take me away from it, and as I say in the piece,
aye,
back then there was no such thing as counselling. It was somewhere in the region of about 4 years ago when I actually sat down with a counsellor and this all came out. And it came out because of other events that have happened to me. So, has it been bottled up? Yes. Why has it been bottled up? Because there was something else in my life to replace it.
Yeah.
And that was music.
Yeah. Well, thank God for it. Thank God for it. What about you, Siobhan?
I don't feel that I can even enter into the realm of being a victim. Because certainly I didn't experience any trauma. I lived in a traumatized environment, but I personally did not suffer anything, so I don't feel entitled to speak about being a victim or not being a victim. I think that would be very audacious of me, and I can't go there.
You, Tom, had a desperate year, just like, well, nobody had a good 72, but you had a desperate year, like the loss of your father, loss of your friend Manus, Brian, you know, and also being young in that year, and all your questions and not anywhere immediate to take them to. Do you think of yourself as a victim?
In conflict situation, and my humble opinion is that everybody's a victim at some description, you know. I think, like, and some greater, you know, than or bigger victims, let's say, you know. But I happen to believe the worst thing about conflict, in my opinion, is that you're forced to take sides. So for me, I think everybody as a victim of some degree. Like Susan's story, I mean, you know, her brother, she's still in the womb, but growing up with parents that were devastated by the death of her brother, who she never met, and the effect of that on her upbringing and the effect of that of witnessing two people, you know, that are devastated and living a life, you know, of grief, mm-hmm, and loss. But I think I think in one sense we're all victims when it comes to war and conflict, mm-hmm, and to some degree. But to define ourselves or to define myself as a victim, no, I wouldn't define myself. I wouldn't put myself in that category. Don't get me wrong. I mean, there were no trauma counselors or psychologists getting ferried into, you know, places in the north of Ireland that were experiencing the intensity of war and conflict. And there was that sort of,
you know, just either, you know, man up or suck it up or get that and yeah. get over it.
Right.
As Papa was saying earlier, you know, but the fact is, you know, we deal with it in different ways, and we sort of, for me, it was like stepping stones, you know, I was permitted or, and I wasn't on my own, there was hundreds, of, you know, that witnessed stuff like I witnessed and experienced stuff that I experienced and went different directions. For me, it was like stepping stones, it was like, it took me on a path of thinking about, you know, mortality and afterlife and spirituality, you know, so in one sense, as an old scripture verse that makes sense to me at this particular moment, is that all things work together for good for them that love God. And it's almost like out of this, you know, like we've seen in Pat's character, there can be healing and there can be resolution and there can be acceptance, you know, but that's the journey. I'm on that journey, and I have been for a long time. But I wouldn't classify myself as a victim, no.
Could just maybe to finish this, can I ask you something, Pat? So we have here a man of music, which in some ways to me is the highest art form. You talked about dancing, the importance of, you know, just going for a bit of release. I mean, we talked, God knows, enough in the piece about things being done to the physical person, but you had some sense, and even the way you embodied it. We have, I would say, one of the most significant artists on this island here. So you're concerned with the redress. I'm a poet, and I mean, I believe in the, as Seamus Heaney talked about, a poetry that's strong enough to help. You know, I don't want to be singing like a wee bird on my own somewhere, and people would tell you, actually, that's all right. Mm-hmm. Go and sing on your own as a wee bird. I don't want to. I want the music to join other streams of music and whatever. But to some extent, but it's a limited extent, you're to the side of this, doing yeah. your, contributing yes. your gift, your considerable gift. But just as an artist, do you believe that all the things that Catherine's talked about victims, about impact, about, you know, this place and where it is and where it needs to go. Do you think, first of all, that that is the business of artists? And if it is, what can art forms offer?
In a word, yes. I think that the medium of art and theatre in particular, I think, is the way through this. You know, we're talking about victims, and personally I feel that if somebody feels like a victim, then they are a victim. It's what they do with those feelings becomes the important thing, you know. You can bottle them up and be affected by what that does with you, or you can get the courage to articulate those feelings in some sort of a meaningful way, which may change your perspective on what a victim is or how you feel. And I think that the theatre is the medium for that, absolutely. And I think it is a very safe space for people to speak, you know, in theatre, especially about such horrific things. I think it's a safe space to speak without judgment, because people are generally very, very much afraid of judgment
yep.
as regards what has happened to them or what has happened to them. And I believe that the arts is the place that can deal with that. Mm-hmm. We talk all the time about honesty, you know, and I've talked about honesty, you know, and I believe honesty without some form of sensitivity
mm-hmm.
equals brutality, you know, yeah. and I believe that the arts can bring a sensitivity to people's stories
mm-hmm.
That allows them that space and gives them that freedom
mm-hmm.
to talk, you know, and very much about talk.
Well, maybe are any of you sitting on something that needs said, or will we just That being the case, in thanking people for staying, could I say, like, we're very, I mean, Victor and I were talking about this earlier, we have a sense, to use Tom's phrase again, that this does not end here, just for us as people who didn't know each other beforehand and who now do. For us, it doesn't end here. So I think we also would have a sense that this is a conversation, that we're hoping to begin a conversation. So maybe we'll just conclude by saying, if anybody wants, you know, to contribute to the conversation, please do so on the platforms that we have in the Digital Playhouse. Please, you know, and there will be some kind of, I think, interaction there. Is that fair enough to say? Yeah. Will we leave it there then?
Yeah, I think we will.
So in drawing to a close, I want to say thank you to Damian, to Kieran, and to everyone at Derry Playhouse for the incredible work that you've done and the incredible work that you do. To all of the participants, both seen and unseen, allow me to thank you on behalf of all of us watching for your grace, for your humility, and for your generosity. You embarked on this journey for yourselves, for your families, for all of us, and ultimately for the healing of Northern Ireland. We owe you a profound debt of gratitude, and be in no doubt that you have honoured the memories of your loved ones and your lives, and enriched all our lives in doing so. Thank you.